Hello once again, welcome back to my YouTube channel. So in today I would like to share my journey on how I became a web developer. So the journey has been quite exciting so far, and I felt like I should tell my subscribers how I did become a web developer. To start with, first and foremost, I was a biomedical engineer. I studied my master's in biomedical engineering, my bachelor's also in biomedical engineering. And so whilst I was in school, I took some courses in programming. Actually, I was really scared of those courses. In fact, I passed with a bare minimum in those courses just because I was introduced to computers at a very older age. So I wasn't used to programming, I wasn't used to using computers. But when I was in my master's program, I had friends who were computer science students. And those guys always used to tell me about their projects and their works and assignments and how exciting it is. So it got me very curious about what they were doing as computer science students. And that started my journey into web development. First and foremost, when I finished my master's, I applied to some jobs in biomedical engineering, but it was so hard to get into those jobs because most jobs would require you to have a certain level of technical expertise. In fact, some of them will even require that you have little bit knowledge in programming. And I was so scared about that. So what I did was, okay, if my own program is telling me to get knowledge in programming, then why don't I get a knowledge in programming and still have the opportunity to return to my program, to my course if I want to, and at the same time start a new career in programming. It means I could kill two birds with just a stone. So I was really excited about that idea. It wouldn't take anything for me if I studied coding. And remember, at the moment, I realized that technology was overtaking the world in so many fields. Even in financing, there is still coding. Even in marketing, you still need to have a knowledge of coding. You need the programming knowledge in life. It's everywhere. And if you don't get used to change, it means that you would sooner or later become useless or redundant in your particular field, because people will take over. So I decided to give it a try and then study coding. So I studied coding after my master's program. I took 3 months. So 3 months of my days during those times to study programming. I took courses on Coursera. Yeah, so I would recommend Coursera to you. And for the particular courses that I took, I would tell you later on in another video. So I took courses in Coursera for 3 months, and I took about 3 courses. So I would admonish that when you start courses on Coursera, you should start from the beginning to the end. It's very common for people to start courses on Coursera or any of those free educational websites and not finish the courses. So what I did was I was dedicated about and committed to the course. So I make sure I finish those courses. Now, the next move I did was I created a portfolio. So first, take the courses. Second, create a portfolio. Now, in creating a portfolio, it's very common for people to think that this program is too small. I really copied and pasted from so many places. It's not really mine. Why should I create a portfolio out of this? No, that is wrong. You can create a portfolio out of anything so far as you understand. So I made sure I understood the project I was doing, and even though I made some mistakes, I couldn't finish some of the assignments. I had to also copy some codes from somewhere, especially on Stack Overflow, trying to understand the algorithms that were used. It still didn't hurt me so much because I understood those that I copied. And so copying is also part of programming. You would have to research. You have to see other people's code. You have to also make your own code. You have to compare and contrast. So in coding, it's a whole lot of dynamics. You shouldn't think it's just one way. There are so many things involved. So after creating a portfolio out of my Coursera courses, I just put everything online and started applying for jobs. Well, when I told my friends I was going to apply for jobs in IT, they were a little bit skeptical because they know I wasn't a computer science student, and why would I go into IT if I haven't done anything related to computers? But I told them I've taken courses in Coursera at least for 3 months, and I'm a little bit confident that even if I can't do anything, I can do data analysis. So my friends didn't really understand me, but I still had the confidence. I wanted to give it a try. When you apply for jobs online, sometimes the companies would call you. And when they call you, they would ask for an interview. And the first interview, you have to talk, right? So I spoke a lot. I told them like the programming, how I was able to use the Python to get some algorithms to work and get some data analysis, data cleaning. I explained everything to them and they were really excited. But then the second part came. They decided to give me a test. And I never knew that a programming test was very different from the courses you take online because it requires a different level of thinking. And so I was really taken aback when I saw those tests, and I failed in most of those tests. And it wasn't surprising to me that I failed because they were quite difficult. Like they were trying to test my understanding of on things I hadn't done before. For instance, a company asked me questions on object programming, and which is part of Python, but it's kind of like advanced level. And I didn't know what to even tell them. I had to literally run away from some interviews because I felt I wasn't fit for that job. And I had to be honest with them and tell them that I'm really sorry. I want to learn. I have the desire to learn. I know these are advanced topics, but if you give me the opportunity, if you give me some time, I would make sure I do a perfect job. So this, some of them were convinced, others were not. Fortunately for me, I got one job offer, and the company decided to give me 3 months of internship. They wanted to see if I could really do what I professed. And so I took that as a challenge to do my best in the company and then show them what I'm capable of doing. And so during the 3 months, I was given a little orientation into what the company was doing and their objectives. And I was given the role of a data analyst. So the company had a lot of data, and then they wanted someone to clean the data and then analyze the data and come up with information from that particular data. And get the steps for achieving that objective wasn't quite difficult because it was something I did in one of those Coursera courses. So my first 3 months was quite easy for me. I went through the processes of cleaning data, trying to analyze the data, and then creating data pipelines. And after that experience, the company decided to give me the job. So they gave me a contract for a year, and then I started with a contract, and within the year, they had to change my role because they had a new project, and the new project was into software development. And at the moment, they had just very few people who could do software development, and so they needed more hands. And the work on data analysis was almost done, so they literally didn't need me there. So I decided to help to move on to the software development part. That was a new challenge. I wouldn't say it was a difficulty for me. I would say it was a challenge because it wasn't something I had done before. So I thought that I could just study and then be able to do it. And lo and behold, it happened. So I was introduced to some software development frameworks in Python. To be specific, I did something we call a Qt Designer. So use the Qt Designer to develop the front end of the software, and then you could use the main Python language to do the backend, which is connecting your databases and then writing your logic statement. So I went through that process and it was quite exciting. I never knew that that was how softwares were made. So I had a lot to learn and I was always busy trying to find information on the internet. In fact, Google was my friend and I was always on Stack Overflow, trying to ask questions, see what people are talking about, read content and a whole lot. And that really helped me during that stage. Now, after the software development part, my company had another project which was on web development. So it was at the same time. So I helped with the software development part. What I did was to develop a login system and then also help them with a little bit of the interface. And then coincidentally, at the same time, they had a web development project, but they didn't have any web developer. So my boss asked me if I could help with the web development. That was my first time. I had no idea about web development. What I did, I'm just a guy who just read online about data analysis using Python, and I just started. So, and then I moved to software development. Now, web development, I have no idea. But I told my boss I would give it a try. So with web development, you have, I would say, you need three teams or three different people. You need a designer, you need a front-end developer, and then you need a back-end developer. So the designer is supposed to just give you the framework, how the software or the web application would look like. For the beginners or those who don't really know much into coding, when we say web application, what we mean is that it's like a software application, but this time around it runs on the web. For instance, Facebook. You could download the Facebook application from Google Store or from your Apple Store, right? But then you could also have Facebook on your browser. So that is the web application, right? Okay. So we had to develop that web application, an application that runs on the browser. And so I first had to do the front end because there were no designers, there were no front end developers, there were no back end developers. I started with the front end and I studied a little bit of some languages like HTML, CSS, JavaScript. And in no particular order, I was just going all over the place trying to get to the objective of the work. So trying to make the interface that they were giving to me. So they gave me a little bit of interface. This is what we want our web application to look like. Please do it for us. So I would try to research how to make this look like that. And then within the process, I had to learn HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and use the combinations of all these three different languages to say and get the application functioning as they wanted. And then after the front end, I was also asked to do the backend part. Well, that was also a new thing to me, but because I was already good or I had already used Python, I could still use the Python for my backend. So that was so good for me. And I was introduced to a new framework, Python framework called Django. So Django is based on Python and you could connect your front end and then you could connect to your databases depending on what database you want to use. So for the new ones, when we say the front end, the back and the back end, the front end is what you see when you open a website, what you see when you click something, oh, so exciting, something pops up. All that you see at the front of the website, a web application, is the front end. And then from the back side is where you have the data and then all other logic operations happening, which you usually don't see. So if you have a form, for instance, on a website, you go to a particular website and then you see a form and it says name, password, or maybe email address. That form, the shape, how it looks like, the structure, that is HTML, CSS, JavaScript. When you click, that is HTML, CSS, JavaScript. But when you enter your details, right? For instance, my name, and then you put in, my name is, let's say, John, right? And then your email address, john@gmail.com, right? And then you submit. When you submit, from that step of from submission, that is where the backend comes into play. So the backend will take the data and then take it to the database. And depending on your request, maybe you want to create a user because you don't have an account, so you want to create a user. That is backend. So when you click, and the backend will create the data user. And then if you want to read, so let's say you want to read information from a particular website, then you enter a keyword. Let's say Google. You want to search for weather, and then you click, you type weather, right? So it means you get information from a particular server. That's the backend. Backend will bring that information from the database and then to the front for you to see. Or perhaps you want to update. Let's say you have your email or your user information on a website, but you want to update your details. Let's say you are called John, but now you want to be called Edwin, right? So when you edit, that is where the backend will take that information and then replace it with the new one. So that's backend. Or you want to delete. If you want to delete information from the server, that is backend. So I used Django for my backend, and it was pretty exciting. And I was almost done with the project, but I had to move to a new company. So I spent 1 year at one company, going through almost a lot of steps from front end to back end, and then working with different databases. Then I moved to a second company. And in my new company, I've been working there for almost 3 to 4 months. And what happened there is that even though they hired me for Django developer, they later realized that their project needed a new programming language. And that is Node.js. Node.js is also based on JavaScript. And I'm new on that, but it's fine. I still do the company. It's okay. I would still go through the process of studying and then working with them. So far, this had been my exciting journey, moving from one programming language to the other. And I'm still hoping to move to a lot of programming languages, because at the beginning, you don't have to stick to one. You need to go all over the place and then become a trade of a lot of languages, but become a master of just one. So in the end, you just choose one. Go around all the place and then choose one in the end. Do I think I would have gone through the same process with the knowledge I have now? With the path, would I have chosen the same path if I had a second chance to start all over again? Well, that would be the topic of a new video. I would give you the path that I took and I would have taken if I'm given a new chance, and some of the mistakes I made along the way. And also, I would also share my opinions about some general topics related to career goals, motivations, and other pressing topics in the world. All right, so this has been my journey so far. It's been quite exciting for me, and I'm happy to share this with you. I will definitely share so many of my stories with you. So I would like you to do well to subscribe to my YouTube channel. At the moment, I still have very low numbers. I hope that you do well to subscribe. This month, my goal is to get to just 200 subscribers. 200 subscribers is my goal. So I'll be counting on you. Please do well to like and subscribe to my YouTube channel and turn on the notification button, because I would be uploading more and more exciting stories about my journey so far. Thank you very much, and see you in another video. Bye.